Urban legends have always had a special place in our culture. A cautionary tale that makes a point, but from a safe place. But deep down, we know it's just a legend, right? Wrong. Sometimes, not always, there are truth to urban legends. And if you think that's all you're going to get tonight, in our second serving, we tackle fake history. Was Shakespeare a black woman? And until very recently, did people just think, really, the earth was flat? Find out this and more tonight on Deep Fat Fried.
Everybody, welcome to another edition of Deep Fat Fried. That's right. Life finds a way, bitch.
Does it though?
No, I don't know.
It always find a way.
And I'll be low energy for the rest of the show. Just blew my whole wad of energy. So
I don't know about that there, TJ boys. I gotta tell you something now. I usually don't get a feeling about a show, but I got a feeling this one's gonna be a cracker.
right you are.
Oh yeah.
Right you are.
Oh yeah, Scotty.
49er prospector Paul.
Oh, Scotty.
There's gold in them there hills, Scotty.
I want that gold.
Got your claim right here, Scotty. Got your name on it. $1,000.
Comes with a pan and a brisket. How can you beat it, Scotty? Own your own stream, overflowing with pebbles of gold, I tells you.
I just want some beef brisket, dude. I heard brisket, and I'm like, man, that sounds really fucking good.
I'll be honest with you, Scotty. The pan that comes with your parcel is but a convenience, for you could just reach down with your hands and scoop it from the streams.
Damn. I'm sold. TJ, can I borrow how much you need, Prospector Paul? What's it going to take?
I'm sorry to have to ask the princely sum of $5,000 American for this parcel of land, but you see, I could easily scoop more than that in one hand and bring it myself. I simply haven't the time. I have many parcels to deal with, you see.
Naturally. TJ, give this guy $5,000. Me and you will split the money 50-50.
All right. Seems legit. Brothers. Let's do it.
I, of course, will be your ever faithful servant. Should there ever be a problem, it shall be easy to find me.
Of course.
My real name has been shared with you. My whereabouts known. A solid deal between solid gentlemen is what I say.
Sounds good. Let's do it. Here's your $5,000.
I morphed into the Southern lawyer.
Yeah.
Because I had to sell it.
Yeah.
The prospector don't sell it. He's the dupe.
Gee whiz, did you hear that guy? $5,000 American will get you a parcel of land where you can scoop gold out of the streams with your hands. Spread the word.
Spread it far and wide.
That's why I love the show. That's why I love the show Deadwood, because it shows you the guys that really made money during those times. I mean, obviously, the 49ers. Yeah, they found some gold, sure, but
most of them not educated people either, but very shrewd nonetheless. Just goes to show you that intelligence is widely misunderstood.
Yep. Yep.
Indeed.
That day is
true. Know what this image, you guys know what this image here is? You guys look at
Candyman. Candyman.
Don't do it, TJ.
Don't
I'm not in front of many times. I'm not in front of a mirror, so it doesn't matter.
Oh, yeah, you are. You're in front of a fucking webcam.
This is that a mirror?
This is 2020, counts, TJ. Dude. It's a digital mirror.
Candyman. Candyman.
You're dead.
Candyman.
I feel bad for you. You're going to choke on a mouthful of fucking bees tonight.
Bees.
This motherfucker is going to make a beehive in your mouth. Bees. And it's over for you.
I like bees, you know? I ain't too dumb.
So Candyman, a work of total fiction, right? No, there's nope. not even a hint of truth to it.
There is
no truth.
It's all true.
Now, obviously, we'll have to get into it, but there is actually some truth to this. Interestingly enough, I was actually surprised to learn this myself. Now, let's move on to our next image. I'm sure you guys know who this is, as educated gentlemen. That's actually a movie poster.
Wow. Yeah, that's also Candyman. That's also Candyman.
Yeah. My thing froze for a second. Do you guys know who this is?
Queen Elizabeth.
Yeah, it's Bloody Mary, dude.
That's actually close that this is one of her siblings.
It's Bloody Mary, dude. Mary. It's Bloody Mary.
So the first...
This is the one we fucking said when I was a kid. You say Bloody Mary, three times you marry the fucking parents and kill you.
Yes, that's correct, TJ.
Yeah.
that is indeed correct. But the first real life urban legend to inspire Candyman is the legend of, as you just said, Bloody Mary. And I'm trying to explain it to you. It varies widely in different parts of the world. TJ was told three times. People have heard five times. It doesn't really matter.
Oh, well, no wonder she never fucking came and killed me, because I was just told you had to say it three times.
Yeah, so you know what? You might actually have to say it five times.
Did you guys ever do Bloody Mary at like a party? Like at a...
Oh,
like a,
yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Had to do it, like, I'm talking at the right time, though. Not at like a birthday party at 8 p.m. right before you went home for the night and got tucked into Betty Weddy, but at like fucking 3 a.m.
Yeah. You know, late at night when everyone's... party. After you've been talking you all kinds legit, of spooky shit. Yeah,
you did
yeah.
a legit Bloody Mary yeah. with other people present.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, late at night. We all ran away, though. Like, no one stayed in the fucking room.
Yeah, everyone ran. Especially after that third time.
Actually, interesting enough to learn, in some of the versions of this urban legend, the ghost is actually benevolent.
Whoa.
Yeah. That's less common. But, and sometimes, you know, Bloody Mary is actually going to be nice to you. Maybe if you're a good Catholic, she's nice to you. In most versions, though, Bloody
that wasn't
Mary...
in my version. In my version was she was going to come right out of the goddamn mirror you were looking in and literally rip your fucking face off and suck your blood and kill you and anybody else that was in the room.
See, I always heard she'd appear behind you and then you'd turn around and she'd fucking kill you in some horrible, like, gory fashion, you know?
That's an interesting difference, because with mine, it was always she was going to grab you out of the mirror. She was going to appear, your reflection would be replaced with her, and then she would come out of the mirror and kill you.
Yeah, I always heard she'd, like, appear behind you, and then you turn,
how many times?
And then she'd slaughter you like a fucking pig or something, you know? She'd, like, slit your throat, she'd gore you, whatever the fuck.
Paul, how many times were you told to say the name?
Three.
That's interesting, because most versions have it as five times into the mirror, which is why Candyman does that. So, like, that's, I guess, something that happened in some subset of the population. You got to say it three times. Like, five was too many.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it was definitely 100% three. It was not five. I would remember.
Yeah, sure. I remember it being three as well.
I only did it. I'll be honest with you guys. Like, I only did a legit Bloody Mary as a kid once. I did it one time, and I remember the fucking mirror I did it in. And it was scary as shit. I thought any second I was going to fucking die. So I know the power this has, at least over like the young mind or whatever.
The pan-shitting fear. Well, at that point in your life, especially when you're little and you have that youthful kind of naivety, it really plays into it, because you believe it is possible. Like, if I say this because people have told me this is true, this could actually happen. So you have that. You're able to suspend your disbelief and have this, like, truly, you know, genuine experience of fear, thinking that this monster...
I was a huge horror fan as a kid, too, so it's like, you know, you really, you're like, you know, I mean, I didn't really believe it, I think, but like there was enough of a possibility in my mind of like maybe that it was fucking freaky, you know?
I think a lot of adults don't really recognize, unless they're around kids a lot, like the level of fear that kids have about like shit happening, like a monster's going to break into my room or someone's going to get into the house or, well, you know.
I also think that like maybe that doesn't exist as much now, but you need to like, it's really unknown that there was a time where word of mouth, like you had to consider it. You know what I mean? There was no great oracle that you could just go type a question to that would immediately call bullshit on bullshit. You know what I mean? Like you,
oh, of course.
Somebody, like if your friend came to you and said, dude, I heard if you say Bloody Mary three times at like 3 a.m. looking in the mirror in the dark, that bitch will come out and kill you. You had to consider it because there was no authority on this. This was something that came down through the grapevine, and sometimes it was true. Sometimes it was, I heard we're going to war with this, or I heard the mayor's gonna got a scandal coming up. He got caught cheating or some shit, and it turns out to be true. But sometimes it's, I heard there's a maniac on the loose. Some bitch was sitting in her car making out with her husband. And a hook was in the door when they drove away. You know, and you had to consider that shit. You had to give it real, genuine consideration.
Whoa.
So, of course, as Paul just alluded to, the second urban legend that serves as an inspiration for Candyman is that of the Hook Man.
Oh, yeah, everyone knows this one.
Sometimes it's called the Hook.
Yeah.
Of course, the story has been adapted many times. You know, we've all heard different versions of it. But it basically goes kind of the same way. A young couple is getting hot and heavy, parked at Lookout Point or Makeout Point or whatever you want to call it.
I like to call it Buttfuck Point, but you can go ahead. Yeah,
the Buttfuck Hut. They're at Buttfuck Huck Point.
They're at Buttfuck Point.
When they hear a radio report, this just in, an escaped mental patient with a hook for a hand is out on the loose. Of course, you know, sometimes it's the couple leaves, but later finds the hook embedded into their car.
That was the version I always heard. Like they fucking hear this, they hear this like scraping and shit. Like,
that happens in my version, but there's a very distinct version in the one that I was told as a kid. A very distinct difference. I mean, the outcome is the same. The kids don't know it. Like you're told one time, this maniac with a hook for a hand escaped from a mental institution, and there were these kids nearby at like Makeout Point sitting in their car or whatever your local thing is, right?
Right. Yeah.
They're sitting in their car and they're fucking or making out or whatever, and they hear this scraping up the side of their door, and the girl starts to say, I want to leave. And the guy's like, no, come on, baby. It wasn't anything. It's just the wind or some, it's probably a badger or something. And she hears more scraping, and then finally she begs him, like, please, please, please let us leave. And so he does, and it's not until the next morning when he goes out to his car that he finds a hook dangling there, along with the newspaper that came that morning announcing that.
Yeah, see, the version I heard was slightly different, where it was like, they hear the radio report of, like, there's a killer on the loose, but the dude's just like, whatever, it's nothing to do with us, who cares? And they start hearing the, you know, and then same fucking story, but then they see it when they're getting out of the car, like, they just see, like, the hook embedded in, like, the door, you know, like it's just there.
He doesn't get like, and it's weird. It's a minor distinction, but it just goes to show you how these things differ regionally, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. And another version of the story, though, because there's actually, of course, as you guys point out, there's two. That's just two slight versions.
Oh, I'm sure there's like fucking them. There's probably countless versions.
The boyfriend leaves the car for some reason, followed by the girlfriend. Hearing a strange sound. Exiting the vehicle to find her boyfriend's dead corpse and or the hook-handed killer.
Yeah, that version goes a lot further. That's like, see, that's just a plot to a horror movie at that point. That's not really a spooky story anymore. That's just like you're just telling the plot of a slasher film then.
I mean, the one where they don't know what almost happened to them is a way better plot for a horror movie, in my opinion, than the, and then she gets out and the dude with a hook is there, you know, like,
and he killed her boyfriend.
I'm glad I grew up in an area where there was a little bit of a storytelling prowess, you know, and people understood the difference between a shit ending and a good ending, you know.
Yeah.
So, obviously, this urban legend, you know, inspired Candyman's weapon of choice, a hook that is jammed into the bloody stump where his hand used to be.
Definitely was a major inspiration, too, behind that that one movie, I Know What You Did Last Summer.
Oh, of course.
Because that guy was like had the same hook shtick going on. Yeah.
So released in 92, Candyman, based on a short story by Clive Barker, of course, remains a potent horror tale, a revenge undertaken by a black artist who was murdered in the 1890s for having a relationship with a white woman. Can't do that. Can't happen. Here is actually, so I know we love to watch trailers on the show. Here's a trailer for Candyman.
Go ahead and full screen this motherfucker.
Already on it.
All right, cool.
You guys ready to watch it?
I'm ready.
Yup.
Yup.
Candyman?
I hope them big old titties bobble out of that, bro.
Oh, yeah, me too.
In cities everywhere.
In titties everywhere?
I watched it from the 90s. I talk like I talked in the 90s. And I make the jokes that I made in the 90s. So you're going to have to give the anachronistic actual trying to be funny shit. But
whatever. Who cares? We're a bunch of immature fucking doofuses. So,
yeah.
Who gives a shit?
I
do want to say that her titties are actually not that big or bobbly. They're mosquito bites, really.
Are you saying, sir, that the titties that were presented at the beginning of this this video would not bobble under any circumstance?
I mean, they might bobble under a particular set of circumstances, but they're not.
It would be quite unique.
Sir, would you go as far as to say a number of particular circumstances these titties would bobble?
I would not say that. No, go back. Go back a couple frames, Scotty. Let's say. Hold on.
And one only circumstance in which the titties presented at the beginning of this trailer would bobble.
Go ahead. You go a little. You don't have to go that far back, Scotty. Yeah, all right. Now go back. There's like a better shot of her fucking full chest a little bit later. Just keep playing.
Candyman.
And
you say his name 5 times.
In cities everywhere.
No.
Pause.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, damn. Well,
all right.
We're in the
pause
now. There we go. Okay. Yeah.
See what I'm saying?
Huh? No. You're not asking the questions here. I'm asking the questions.
Oh,
you
okay.
You said that there is this one situation and one situation only in which these titties would bobble.
I didn't say quite that. I just said that they're not very bobbly titties. They're little mosquito bite titties.
So you're revising your testimony at this point?
I mean, I'm just saying I don't. Yeah, I'll go so far as to say these titties won't bobble.
Oh, so
yeah, I'm going. I'll take it to that extreme. These titties are not bobbling titties.
You flailed on the stand, so you've gone from.
Well, I'm getting a better look at these titties, and I'm just saying.
Would these titties and would these titties not bobble, TJ?
That's the question before us, Judge. And I'm trying to get our witness here to corroborate, but
you are an impertinent witness, TJ.
I'm the one with the gavel here, so.
Let me tell you something, sir. TJ, I will hold you in contempt of this court.
These titties will not bobble.
They will not bobble.
These titties will not bobble.
Under any particular circumstances.
Under no circumstances will these titties bobble. These are barely titties.
The court finds you.
I got much bigger titties than this bitch, is all I'm saying.
We hold you in contempt, TJ.
Yeah.
Silence.
All right.
Bailiffs, arrest this man. Take him into custody.
The truth hurts.
Hold you in contempt for 35 million years, TJ.
Truth hurts.
Fair enough.
These titties would bobble.
All right.
They whisper his name.
Well, let's see if they bobble in the trailer.
Candyman.
It's just a story.
Candyman. He's about to bobble him right there. They're not going to show you the bobble.
Ghosts. They better. Bobble them titties, Candyman. Show me if them titties can bobble.
Candyman.
Bobble man. Bobble man. Bobble man. If you say bobble man in the mirror 5 times, he'll show up and bobble them titties.
Helen, a woman died in there. Leave it.
Her titties were bobbled until she died. He bobbled the titties so hard, he bobbled them clean off. Sorry, I'm a piece of shit. I'll shut up.
Folklore. Everyone
Everyone wanted their titties buffed.
Pretty safe around here.
I don't scare too easy.
Don't know about Ruthie Jean. They ain't never gonna catch him. Who? Candyman.
Girl, you don't even have enough titty to bobble.
You're wrong. You're wrong, Bonquifa.
Bonquifa? Okay.
That's how they named every black person back in the 90s.
Back in the 90s. Huh?
Candyman will be the judge of that.
They all had these, like, you know, like Africanized names. They were all like that. It would have been something else, like Latifa or... What's the name of this character in the movie? I bet it's something like...
All right.
Shaniqua.
I will look that up. I'm getting on research right now. If it's a stereotypically black name, I owe you. I don't know what I owe you.
But, and if it isn't, I did a racism and I apologize.
Yeah.
Ahead of time.
So we're going to find out if you're racist or if you're just accurately describing the Moors of the time.
I wish we had the Jeopardy music so we could play it.
I should put that on my board. I put all this dumb shit on my board. I got like the Los Locos thing.
Los Locos kick your ass. Los Locos kick your face. Los Locos kick your balls into outer space.
I mean, that's a pretty good drop.
But when am I going to use that? You know what I mean?
Never. Exactly, never. But the Jeopardy music, though?
Yeah, I could use that in all kinds of situations, so I should have that for sure.
It'd probably get us fucking flagged if we use
No. People play that shit all the time, dude. All right, so fucking... I'm on fucking IMDb here.
Yeah, yeah.
What the fuck is this? Why Candyman there fucking show me a 1968 short? All right, more title matches. Scotty's got it. So this is 92.
It's called Do a Racism. Or is TJ going to have to apologize?
Oh, Paul? Shit, Paul.
I know.
Shit.
And our answer is in with TJ.
So
TJ, go ahead and give us the answer.
There's a few black women in this, so let me make sure this is the right one.
Uh-huh.
But I believe it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So the name of this character is Anne Marie McCoy. So they gave her pretty much the whitest name ever.
I apologize for having done a horrible act of racism.
You're a fucking racist, Paul.
My contrition is bottomless. I'm a worm. I will lick the boot of the next black king I see on the street.
Oh, Paul, sorry. We have to give that buzzer just a few more times.
Poor Anne Marie here.
Anne Marie McCoy.
She sounds like an Irish like pharmacy owner from the 1800s.
That's her name, Paul.
Oh, your rheumatoid's acting up. You need to go see Anne Marie McCoy down the pharmacy. She's got a root you can chew. Cures what ails you, does.
It's called the Laquisha root.
Oh, fuck you, TJ.
You just did a racism. Now you apologize.
I'm so sorry.
Now, she is about to discover...
Helen? Get out!
What's behind the mystery?
You're sick.
What's behind the legend?
Listen, he's under the bed!
Oh, wait. She was just shaking around. I want to see if her titties were going to bobble in that scene, but they don't give you a good titty bobble angle.
Yeah, hospital gown. That's not enough.
Don't show bobbling titties.
Well, you could probably see them bobble through the hospital gown. If they were.
I mean, if you get some big old floppy quadruple D's or something, you see them bobbling through the hospital gown.
Yeah.
I ain't claiming she has that. I'm just claiming what she do have would bobble. Then
you don't have to believe.
That's exactly right. And TJ, you don't have to believe those titties would bobble because they would bobble under a number of different circumstances. Those titties would scientifically bobble. They would satisfy a committee of physicians and physicists who would come to a consensus on what a bobble is. And then those titties would do it under a number of circumstances.
Maybe you're right, Paul, but, to actually talk about this movie briefly, I will say that I was a big horror fan as a kid, and I watched a lot of horror movies. I watched this one a couple times, and it really did not leave much of an impression on me. I haven't seen it. I don't think I've seen it as an adult. Maybe I have. But it was never really my favorite thing. I mean, it was kind of I don't know.
Can I give you a theory that I have?
Yeah.
I actually read an article about this written by, I don't know, somebody who was probably a feminist or something. Not that that's a bad thing.
Sure, whatever. Lens to look at the world through, whatever.
That says that a lot of like black people latched on to this film because it had a lot of black protagonists and it had a black antagonist, and it was unapologetically black in the way that the people spoke. Like, you heard mm-hmm. Anne-Marie McCoy there. She, if you go back and listen to her, she's speaking, you know, like yeah. she's not using like proper British elocution. She's speaking like black people speak,
right?
You know, in a lot of different places.
Sure.
And people liked, and black people didn't get a lot of representation on the screen in that way at the time, well, especially in horror.
It was very just
like an offhanded killable character. Like, it was very rare for the main villain to be a powerful, strong, well-spoken black man. And to have a cast filled with black women as well.
Sure.
And other black folk.
And the, well, it looks like this. It looks like the 2021 remake that's going to be coming out is going to even be more focused on black American shit.
Which so. I think it should, honestly, because like, I think the reason, honestly, I wasn't into this movie was because I was so used to seeing myself up there that I looked at a movie where I didn't really see a representation of myself in the main characters. And I was like, meh. Probably not going to be interested in this. Made my mind up before I went in, you know, not out of an act of overt racism or conscious racism, but maybe like, I guess, privilege or whatever the fuck.
Sure. I mean, I don't remember the blackness being the issue for me, but maybe it was.
I don't remember going like, oh, too many black people in this movie.
Right.
I remember
watching
it. Like, but when I saw the trailer, I was like, eh. And when I watched it, I was like, eh. And I think that might be the reason. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I feel like it's just like I thought Candyman was cool, and I liked a lot of his kills, and I liked the things with the bees. But it just, I think for me, it was just too slow, especially in the beginning. But I had that complaint about a lot of movies. I was an ADHD fucking kid, so
yeah.
This movie really is, especially towards the beginning, kind of a slow burn.
It is. I would say this, TJ. Like,
yeah.
You haven't really changed much of the ADHD shit.
No.
But number two, the reason you felt like it was so authentic, Paul, was because the guy that directed this, Bernard Rose, all this was shot in the Chicago projects. There's a specific like building that's famous in that area, but the name escapes me. But yeah. The filming was done there, and it had to be done with the basically the gangs that run its permission. So like they had to put like extras in the movie were actually people who lived in that community.
Mm-hmm.
That's like that's basically how it worked.
I figured you pulled some of this. I've heard some of the different other ways that this was a very like actually special movie for that for the black community in America at a time, especially for horror fans. You know what I mean?
Right.
Oh yeah, 100%, man. But it's interesting that part is that's not what the part I focus on. I'm focusing on the part that's actually where's the kernel of truth here.
Right.
So it's mainly false, obviously. You know. You're not going to go look in a mirror and fucking say Candyman five times or Bloody Mary or whatever five times and have them jump out and kill you. You know, burst through the fucking, you know, the glass, slit your throat, impale you, whatever fucking Candyman or Bloody Mary has in store. But however, though, there is some truth to this. In 1987, the Chicago Reader published a story about Ruth McCoy, a woman living in a Chicago housing project, who made a frantic call to 911, insisting that she was being attacked in her apartment. Responders eventually found her dead of gunshot wounds. Investigators determined that her assailants had gained access to her unit by breaking through the connecting wall in the adjoining apartment and climbing through her medicine cabinet. The complex was actually built this way intentionally, so that plumbers who had to come in and investigate leaks could simply remove the cabinet to check the pipes. Not a great design, though, because it actually became a frequent mode of entry for burglars, and in McCoy's case, her killers.
Crazy. So that they probably also got the McCoy name from there.
I see.
If we go here, we can actually see something from 1987 when this happened. This is actually the suspect. It says, 2D suspect charged in slaying robbery.
2D, holy shit.
Yeah, 2D.
It's like a cartoon character.
A Southside man was indicted Tuesday in the slaying of a woman whose attackers broke into her apartment through a medicine cabinet. And we're not going to go through it because I already went through the story, but it's actually very interesting what happened here. If we go down here, so McCoy heard the break-in, so she hears someone breaking in through the cabinet and called the 911 emergency number. About 10 to 15 minutes later, before police responded, another 911 caller reported hearing four gunshots coming from the apartment, Kelly said. Kelly said the police arrived, knocked on the door, got no answer, and left. Now, I wouldn't, like, that to me was insane. It's like, so they heard someone get shot in this apartment, and they're not going to do anything. So I looked into it more, and I found what happened is the cops all showed up there pretty quickly, and also the security for the building. They're like, well, there's reports of a gunshot. There's reports of someone breaking into this apartment. We're going to knock on the door. No one answers the door, obviously, because she's dead inside. So they're like, we should break down the door. The apartment's security, though, was like, look, we could break down this door, but that's going to be a real big fucking hassle. I mean, we're going to have to secure the door. We're going to have to get people for maintenance out. I mean, I don't know if they're going to come out this time of night. I mean, it's going to be a big fucking deal if we go break down this door. So that everyone just decides, like, well, we don't want to call the maintenance guy to see if this person was actually murdered in this apartment or not. Let's all just go home. So, of course, a few days later, they get a call because no one had seen McCoy. Police finally then entered her apartment to find her body. She had been shot in the chest. Who has convictions for robbery and theft, was being held in Cook County Jail on a $10 million bond. So I guess this is the guy that killed her. But so I thought it was kind of interesting that there was some truth at this medicine cabinet thing. So him busting through in that one scene we saw very briefly in the trailer has some kernel of truth to it, because these killings, obviously, this killing did take place. And you know, obviously, a lot of these break-ins obviously took place here. So this wasn't really uncommon or unheard of in this area to do this.
Cool. Yeah.
I know you guys will probably know this next one, too. You guys will probably like this one. You guys know who this is?
No.
Blow him up a little bit. I can't really see him.
Blow him up. Explode him.
I don't have a clue who this is.
No, I thought that would be the case, but you probably have heard his story. And this one's called, and as soon as I say this, you guys will probably figure out who this is. This glass sure is strong.
Oh, yeah. So this is that dude this is that dude that, like, jumped towards the window because he's, like, thought it would, like, not break or whatever the fuck, but then it did and he fell to his death. Is it that guy?
Yes, it is. And he was a Canadian.
Fucking Canadians.
This sure is strong, eh? Watch. I'm going to moose charge it, eh? No. Stand back. It's cool. It'll stop a bullet. It'll stop me, eh? Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
And then he died. And then, my friend, you die. It's a pretty lame fucking death, dude.
Yeah.
Like, your friends
remembered as a dumbass forever.
Yeah.
This is one of those things that, like, you inevitably hear someone tells you, like, man, you ever heard about this fucking... And no one really knows the details, usually. So I thought it'd be kind of interesting to look into a little bit more. So, pretty much everyone's heard the tale of a lawyer who had a peculiar fondness for running full bore into his office windows to demonstrate how strong they were. No one really knows why he did this, by the way. And most people describe this guy, like, some people have floated, oh, this guy was suicidal. Pretty much everyone says he was not suicidal. He was just, like,
just a dumbass.
He just, like, well, actually, I'll tell you this. Well, we'll get to that in a second. The practice caught up to him eventually as he crashed into a window and went sailing to his death. The hobby was actually practiced by a guy named Gary Hoy, a senior partner in an area law firm with an office on the 24th floor. So on July 9th, 1983, Hoy made his signature tackle against the window to impress some visiting law students. The pain finally broke and sent him plummeting to his death. In a eulogy, managing partner Lars called Hoy one of the best and brightest at the firm.
Wait a minute. Well, that doesn't speak well for the firm.
By the way, the firm actually collapsed after his death. It did not long after. He was actually apparently a linchpin there, And the firm actually did go out of business a few years later.
Well, so wait. So here's the thing I never knew about this story. I'd heard this story before, and I knew it was true because I think I saw an episode of Mythbusters where they like covered it, and they reported that, yeah, this actually did happen. But I'd always kind of heard that like he was at a party or something, like it was an office party, and it was like he was like a little drunk maybe, and he fucking ran at the window. But you're basically telling me this dude like repeatedly would do this all the time to this window?
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
And he was not drunk.
No, just,
was
just like this is like
some people.
He's just like, look how strong this window is. Look how strong this window is. Look how strong this. What the fuck?
So of course,
man.
We go to Snowpiercer. Yeah. Obviously, many rumors are spread on the internet, and so the claim is a Toronto lawyer demonstrating the safety of the window panes, and a skyscraper plunged through a window to his death.
Yep.
And the rating of it is true.
Yeah. Like I said, I already knew that from the Mythbusters episode, but yeah, I never knew the full story where he was like repeatedly fucking like weakening this window over time.
Yeah, so you
like basically begging this window to break.
Well, see here actually, that and that even gets into it further on Snopes. So for motivations that remain unclear to this day, Hoy had apparently developed a fondness for showing off the tensile strength of the office building windows. And or demonstrating his fearlessness, his fearless trust in the aspect of building design by running and hurling himself at the window panes in front of onlookers who would watch the stunt that always end up with Hoy bouncing off the wind of the window's panes, leaving both glass and lawyer unharmed. Oh, my God. On the fateful day in 1993, however, Hoy attempted his feat in front of a group of prospective legal apprentices with disastrous results. So we obviously know what happened.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine being one of those people?
Oh, wait. Wait, wait. Actually, I did not know this. Apparently, the first attempt came off as a casual with Hoy harmlessly bouncing off the window. But he actually threw himself. Oh, I actually did not realize this detail. I'm sorry. So apparently, he actually did this one time in front of them and survived. Then he did it again. And that's when it popped out of his frame and sent him tumbling to his death.
Dude. Can you imagine being one of those people? Like, you're just, like, a student from this, like a law student, and you're, like, at this, like, law firm and shit, and there's this fucking lawyer, and he's like, check out how strong this window is. Look at this. And he, like, jumps at it, and you're like, whoa, okay, cool, dude, but no, it's fine. Look, I'll do it again. He fucking falls to his death right before your eyes. You're just like, okay, well, all right. I guess that's a memory I have now. Cool. Thanks.
So let's go here. We do know that his early demise could have been avoided had he left the testing to experts or consulted the structural engineer, Bob Greer, who later told the Toronto Star, I don't know of any building code in the world that would allow a 160-pound man to run up against a glass and withstand it. So his idea that this is like just it should have been that strong was completely misguided. No one's building it to that specs.
I know.
That's shocking.
I know, right? Yeah, for a structural engineer to be like, actually,
in fact, in order to test this out, I'm going to the first glass skyscraper I can find, the closest one, and I'm running at one of the windows on the top floor because there's only one way to be sure.
I mean, that's true.
There's only one way to truly know how strong the window is.
And this one, I mean, you guys might be aware of this one.
Now, this I have heard this, but I always assumed it was total bullshit. But I'm seeing a little true and a check mark, so I'm guessing it's not.
Well, we'll get to this article in a second here, but we'll kind of read you, of course, the setup for this. So, vacationing couples, newlyweds, Disneyland guests, all of them the subject of an urban legend involving hotel occupants who fall blissfully asleep. Only to wake up to an awful stench coming from either under the bed or inside the mattress. Closer inspection reveals a dead body has been stashed away. And of course, presumably not anyone who died of natural causes. And I'm sure you guys remember the movie Four Rooms.
Yeah. There was like a dead hooker under the mattress of the the bed in one of the segments. It was like the one where he's
after
babysitting.
I saw that movie. Yeah, after that movie, I've always been like, okay, you got to check under my mattress. Dead hooker, dead hooker, dead hooker. So far, I have not found a dead hooker. But doesn't mean you might not, though. So this traveling tale has been confirmed multiple times over. So there's a number of examples of this happening. At least a dozen newspaper stories have detailed hotel rooms that have doubled as body disposal sites. While the smell is usually apparent right away, at least one couple slept on a mattress containing a body in Atlantic City in 1999. So they didn't even know. Cases in Colorado, Florida, and Virginia have also been reported. And of course, here's the claim. A vacationing couple stayed in a foul-smelling motel room, discover a body hidden inside their bed. But it's actually true. Actually, interesting enough, they can actually date the appearance of this legend in 1991. Unlike a number of other such gruesome tales, legend appears to have sprung from a misremembering of any number one of actual news items. So that's a bunch of like news stories that people kind of collectively remember together. So here's a number of cases here. On July 10th, 2003, a man checked into the Capri Motel just east of downtown Kansas City and began complaining about a foul odor in his room. Management told him nothing could be done about the problem, and he spent three nights in his room before checking out because
that sounds like management, by the way.
Yeah, nothing we can do. He simply no longer stand the smell. When the cleaning staff came into the makeup room on July 13th, they lifted the mattress and underneath found a man's body in an advanced stage of decomposition.
What do you want me to tell you to do? Wash under your arms? If your apartment stinks, clean it. Next.
Oh, my God.
Meanwhile, there's a decomposing woman.
Or no man, big deal.
A man.
I was a man. On July 10th, 1999, we talked about this one a second ago, the rapidly decomposed remains of 64-year-old Saul Hernandez were discovered inside a bed in room 112 at the Burgundy Motor Inn in Atlantic City, New Jersey. A German couple had spent the night sleeping over Hernandez's remains, and it was their complaint to the manager about the smell in the room, which led to the discovery of the corpse. I guess that manager took it a little more seriously, like, why does the room smell like a dead person?
Was it? Did it say it was a German couple?
It was.
Dude, I bet that's exactly how he treated them. I bet he was like, here in America, we have this thing called a shower. And when you go into it, the room stops stinking so bad. Maybe the two of you could go use ours, huh? Go back to your room and let some water go over your body and put some soap underneath your arms and in your ass crack and underneath your fucking undercarriage there. Scrub it around real good. And what do you want to bet? The smell disappears, huh? Good night.
That's awesome.
But this one is crazy.
We are very clean people. No, I can't listen. I don't speak that kraut, okay? I don't understand a word you're saying. But, sir, we are very clean people is what I'm saying. I don't understand the word you're saying, pal. Listen, if you stink, all right? I can't do nothing for you. Here's a bar of soap, all right? There's one just like it, complimentary, right up in your room, all right? Right on the next to the sink.
Damn, Paul. Paul's whole fucking thing. There's a dead body in the room. The manager's the fucking.
I guarantee you that's what happened to these fucking people. Instead, they went and complained to management. How do you think that went? You know
what I mean? It smells like there might be a dead body.
Yeah, I can smell it from here, pal. All of you smell like that, okay? You come off the fucking boats and the planes reeking like that.
Next. How about this one, guys?
You smell it in your own country, but I guess their whole country smells that way. Next.
I guess these guests here are fucking, they're some real champs, man. Because in July 1996, a woman's body was found under a mattress in the Colorado Boulevard Travelodge in Pasadena, California. Apparently, the motel staff discovered her 10 days after her demise, and only after guests had complained for several days of a foul odor coming from that room.
Wow.
Damn.
Yeah, that's, that's the kind of thing that, like, you really have to vet these smaller places where you crash. Like if you're the reason you go to one of these bigger chain type of places and pay more, like I know some people can't afford it. And I've been one of those people most of my life. So if you got to go to like a Motel 6 or a Motel 8 or even worse, like a Delray Motel, you know what I mean? When I say a Delray Motel, just a motel that isn't branded at all. You have to vet them, dude, because you never know what's gone on in these fucking places. finding a Motel 6 that's like run by people that are genuinely clean and responsive is like finding a nugget of gold, man. Hold on to those.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Here's a change of pace, though. Not murder by death by misadventure. In Rosedale, Maryland in 1987, an unidentified man died of a drug overdose after one of the 34 balloons of heroin he'd swallowed burst. It's not good. When you're a drug mule and your shit bursts inside you, you know, you're dead. Sorry.
I mean, kind of the best death by misadventure ever, though. Like, if I got to pick a fucking way to go out doing something stupid, it's having a balloon of heroin blow up my ass, because you know that, like, the whole lead up to that is just euphoria. You know what I mean? And then you just kind of like drift into a dreamless sleep and that's it. I mean, there are way worse ways to go in my book.
Of course, his partner stashed the corpse under the bed, and of course he split. I mean, he's not going to stick around for that. 3 days later, the family the room was rented next to complained about the odor, and this led to the body's discovery. You always got to check, man.
Yeah.
I guess one of the oldest smelly body left under the bed sightings comes from 1982. Richard Kalinske, Daniel Deppner, and Gary Smith often teamed together to run auto theft scams. Kalinske and Deppner decided to kill Smith. I don't know. Maybe they didn't like his name. It was just too common.
That's the Iceman. Yeah, Richard Kalinske is the Iceman. Yeah.
It's like, Smith. Gross.
They accomplished this by feeding him a cyanide-laced hamburger in North Bergen, New Jersey motel room. Kalinske finished off Smith by strangling him and watching Smith die of poisoning. When watching Smith die of poisoning proved tiresome. Dying too slow. Die!
Yeah, I'm bored with this death. Die a little faster.
They stuffed his body under the bed and left it there. Yeah, it makes sense. I think we've definitely proven this one fucking happens.
So not only that, not only has it happened, it's happened multiple times. So, you know, there's lots of
Of course. I mean, with a hotel room, though, that's kind of to be expected.
Yeah. Well, Seattle Times wants me to unblock ads, and I'm not going to do it. So suffice it to say, this happened too. Corpse found under Memphis, Tennessee motel bed where couples slept. We've already heard a number of them anyways.
So, yeah, the point is it happens. It happens, you know, every now and again.
Well, enough of these urban legends, TJ. Enough of them.
Enough. You're pissing me off with these urban legends.
Some fucking fake ass history, TJ. Some shit.
I'm sick of these fucking urban legends, Scotty. You're pissing me off.
Some shit they told you in school, TJ, that your dumb ass probably fucking believed.
Scotty, you're pissing me off, Scotty. You're pissing me right the fuck off, you piece of shit.
Fuck you, TJ. You're a piece of shit.
All right, teach me what I've learned that was fucking false. And if I disagree with any of it, I'm gonna...
TJ, look, you probably believe this, actually. TJ, is the Earth a sphere, or is it flat?
Well, let me tell you something, Scotty. I've watched some documentaries about this. And, you know, I was watching a documentary. There was a dude. He was standing right there on the Puget Sound. And he's looking at the city of Seattle, and he's like, you know what? If the Earth was round, like, quote-unquote science claims, then that city should be hidden around the curvature of the Earth, but it's not. I can see it perfectly clearly. And it was at that moment I realized that this whole bullshit about the Earth is round is a bunch of fucking lies. Pack of lies. Pack of nonsense.
Hooey, says I.
So, well, you know what, Peter, I'm glad you have that to say.
Earth is flat as a goddamn pancake, Scotty.
You know, I can't speak for Paul, but at least 2/3 of people in this podcast, I mean, doing research into it, guys, the Earth is definitely flat.
Absolutely. 100% flat.
We all know it now. It's flat. I mean, this is actually the most accurate representation of Earth you're ever going to see. I mean, look, let's enhance this a little bit so people can just see.
How?
This is the planet you're living on right now. This is what it looks like. I mean, look, accepting this doesn't change the fact that, you know, you're still living on the planet. You're still living where you're at right now. You're at. Just don't go off the edge.
Dude, I don't mean to interrupt this shit, but I locked this cat the fuck away. I locked him up. There's no way he should have been able to escape. And yet here he fucking is. He just fucking walked in. He just opened the door and walked in here for the fucking third time today.
He's a demon, dude. You know, you got to get a lock on your door.
Well,
Welcome to cat ownership, TJ.
I know. It's fucking, what the fuck?
I'm learning too, man. Cricket is the first cat that I've ever like been, you know, directly, partially responsible for taking care of long term, you know?
Yeah.
And so I've had to learn all like the little cat protocols and shit. And one of them is you never really know where a cat is. That's like basically rule number one. Because like you can put a cat somewhere, but that doesn't mean he's going to stay there.
Yeah, but there's like a little lock mechanism on the area. Not, whatever. I'm going to go put him away again. But go ahead. Proceed. Sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt, but it's fucking.
No, that's fine. Dude, I have those rounded handles. So the cats, they can paw at the door and try to, and they can get them open if they're ajar a little bit. But if they're totally closed, my cats cannot do shit. Fucking TJ, dude. That cat just dominates him. The cat fucking dominates him.
Dude, who is whose pet is what I want to know. Because from where I stand, TJ's a pet.
No, TJ is. He's Cornelius's pet, dude. Like, I know for a fact right now that anything Cornelius wanted, TJ would just fucking do. He might fucking be like, man, too expensive. TJ's going to pay for it. I don't have a doubt in my mind. It's really weird because, like, Cornelius is like the one animal, like I've never seen Cheetah have much of a bond with any of, like, I know he likes him. Like, I know he likes Salvador and shit. But it's always kind of like, Salvador, I'm going to spend 5 minutes with you, then, you know, that's it. But Cornelius and Cheetah have a special bond, dude. It's a weird thing.
True.
I'm back.
Did you get, we're just saying you have a weird, I mean, I don't want to derail this episode, but you have a very weird bond with Cornelius.
What the fuck?
He's back. Just give
fucking
up.
Fucking Squeaks is in here now.
God damn it, TJ.
See, this is what I'm talking about, dude.
Trying to educate you. What are you saying, Paul?
I'm just saying, like, cats are like, you can't. They're going to go where they fucking please. It's like, you remember back in the day when they. Because Squeaks kept hurting himself.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Like, they were like, you know, like, we can't let him out, even though that's what he wants. And they keep, there's this constant, like, cyclical struggle to keep Squeaks inside. But you can only just temporarily keep Squeaks inside. Like, he makes a plan and executes it one day, and he's out.
Yeah.
Dude, you remember the three of us, like, the fucking Keystone Cops, trying to corral that fucking cat and then finally just giving up?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's no way. Once he's out, he's out. He's wise to it. That's the thing about cat ownership. It's like, you know, I'm lucky that my cat doesn't want to go outside. Like he's like, this is my fucking domain right here. I want to go out on the porch sometimes and look at the outside, but I'm afraid. I don't even want to take a step out there. He doesn't have that wanderlust shit.
Yeah.
So, but I'm lucky. But, I'm pretty lucky because of the fact that Manson, he just tends to stick around the house. Like, He'd gone out for like a while, and I just found him in the yard. Well, I also was fortunate too, because it was his dinner time, so he wasn't going far. He's like, I gotta get that food. But TJ, look at this guy right here, TJ. You want to be this dude right here? Look at here, TJ.
Yeah, look at him.
Be him.
He's there, fucking sticking his head through the firmament that separates the heavens from the earth and shit. What the fuck is going on?
Damn,
you're not meant to do that, TJ.
What happened to this guy? Did his head get chopped off?
So this is a. Some common knowledge. Everyone hears this, you know, about the Middle Ages over and over again. The fucking peasants, the medieval people, from the king to the lowliest peasant, they're pretty much like, but really, you know, hey, the earth's flat. It's fucking flat, TJ. Well, you already know that. And of course, you guys have probably heard this.
There's
one
still
too.
A significant number of people who believe that shit today. So, I mean, like.
I know. That's what I'm saying. People still believe it, but the majority of people now believe the earth is round. Or spherical, or whatever the fuck you want to say.
Either the earth is flat, or TJ ain't fat.
And of course, this is usually coupled with, because you hear this in like, you know, like fifth grade history or fourth grade history or whatever. The Columbus, we all love him, faced opposition to his attempt to find a western route to Asia because people thought the earth was flat and he'd just fall off. Sounds right, guys. You know, Columbus wanted to go around. He wanted to fucking circumnavigate the globe.
Uh-huh.
And they're just like, no! Can't be done! It's a flat plane! the four corners of the earth, you'll fall off.
Yeah, that's that was not the concern. The concern was that they thought that Columbus thought the earth was much smaller than yes. most people did, and actually the other people were right. If there hadn't been another whole continent that we didn't know about, Columbus would have been fucked.
Yeah, but most of the time,
his whole thing, wasn't it like trying to find a quicker way to get to India for the spice trade and shit?
Yeah,
to
and the West Asia, Indies. Yeah.
Yeah, the West Indies is where
so he was trying to find, he was trying to go around because he just figured, like, all I got to do is cross this vast ocean in a straight line and I'll land right in the heart of, you know, all of this trade.
And then a bunch of people rightly pointed out, like, no, the earth is way too big. That ocean goes on for a really long time, and there's no way you could sail the whole thing. And if not for the fact that there was a whole other continent, or a couple of them actually, out there that was just not known to Europeans at that time, they would have been right.
Well, I've got to actually, I'm looking at an article here. I've got a direct quote from Columbus when he was confronted with that. It says, nuh-uh.
Nuh-uh.
Yeah. That I believe is in my research as well.
Scotty, I know that this is a related but kind of a little tangential, but I do have some polling numbers on Flat Earth today.
Okay.
And, like, what people believe about it now. Sure. So I'm just going to give you the total numbers, although they are broken down by age as well. So the statement, I have always believed the world is round, 84%. The statement, okay. I always thought the world was round, but more recently, I am skeptical / have doubts, 5%. Okay. I've always thought the world was flat, but more recently, I am skeptical and have doubts. So this is like flat earthers who are like, maybe it's round, 2%. I have always believed the world is flat, 2%. Other / not sure, 7%.
Oh, I wonder why humanity is struggling as mightily now as it is. Is it flat? Is it not flat? Is it
By the way,
too stupid to live, too rare to die, dude.
By the way, the younger the people are, the more likely they are to believe the earth is flat. Among 18 to 24 year olds, the number who believe the earth is round is only 66%.
So can I get a little deep? Can I get a little deep in my analysis of this and a little bit of bullshit, you know, out there? Maybe I don't know. Like I have some thoughts on this.
Go ahead.
Number one, how heavily do you think Poe's Law comes into play in this?
Remind me what that is. Hold on.
That's, you know, a Poe is somebody who's pretending to be something.
Guys, we all have TV in, so just banter for a second.
To make a satirical point. But
oh, gotcha.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Without a winking or smiling, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, I'm sure it probably plays into some of that for sure. There's probably at least some people who are just like, for the memes, the earth is flat.
And then on top of that, you're talking about younger people. Who are, I mean, this current generation, the Zoomers or whatever, they're the most fucking cynical generation in history. When it comes to like advertising, sloganeering and polling and shit, they live to fuck it up.
Well, I don't think this poll asked any Zoomers. I think the youngest this one goes is millennials, because it's 18 to 24 in 2018. I
mean, millennials led into Zoomers, so right. Yeah, same thing applies. Millennials are the internet generation, or part of it, the meme generation, or whatever the fuck.
Memes.
So they're, you know, like polls themselves are complete. I mean, I don't want to say completely unreliable, but I think people lean way too heavily on them.
Sure.
Polls are good theoretical snapshots of possible outcomes and shit, but it's been widely shown that people very often do not answer truthfully on polls.
Yeah.
Whether they have something at stake or not. So, you know, like, these people might just be like trying to, it might be like a more covert Church of the fucking Spaghetti Monster or whatever the fuck, you know?
Yeah. Dude, I've seen, I watched a documentary, or at least part of it, on these flat earth people. And I could tell you right now, I figured out within like 10 minutes what was motivating these motherfuckers. And it was like, well, money could be a thing, but more than that, it was just clear that these people wanted to feel special. and they wanted to have the inside scoop on some, like, truth that no one else knows. And so they fucking sit around cooking up arguments for why the earth is flat. And then they fucking, they go around bragging. Like, they literally go around bragging to people like, I've got the biggest flat earth group on Facebook. I've got the biggest flat earth group on Facebook. They, like, introduce themselves to people like that. They have, like, shirts and shit that say, like, I am a flat earther. Ask me about the flat earth, you know? So it's like they really want to feel super special.
Are they that desperate for attention in their lives where it's all like they literally the first thing you like you meet someone like, hey, how you doing? I'm in the biggest flat earth group on Facebook, just so you know. It's like, who gives a fuck, dude? I don't fucking care. Wow. I literally don't care if you
get the fuck away from me.
It's like, I don't fucking give a shit, dude. People try to pull that shit. I only had a couple people try to pull that shit with me where it's like, I run this or that. I'm just kind of like, dude, I've always been like, who cares?
I know I've told this story to you guys before. I don't know if I've ever told it on a show, but that fucking dude at the Diablo release. Do you remember that shit?
No. No, I don't think I do.
I waited in line. I won't take too long, but quick digression.
I don't give a shit.
I waited in line out in front of a Best Buy in Fresno, California for Diablo's midnight release. Diablo 3.
My apologies.
Right? I know. And one of the dudes, so like they had us line up outside. You could tell there was clearly not a plan until they realized that there were going to be about 100 people there to pick up their orders that night. And they're like, okay, everybody line up. And we're like, all right. So we did, right? And of course, everybody's trying to get close to the beginning so we don't get screwed. So I end up somewhere in the middle of the line and I figured they've at least got enough to cover this. I'm fine. And I was right. They did. I had a collector's edition or whatever. But one of the dudes that was in the line was this dork, right? And he was talking like it became really apparent to me, because at first I thought he was with a bunch of other people. But it became apparent to me at some point that he was not. Like, he was like engaging people in line that were near him in conversations that they didn't want to be having. And it was all centered around My Little Pony. It was all like, you know, it's actually a very misunderstood cartoon. My Little Pony is thought to be a cartoon that's just for little girls. But actually, there are many lessons to be learned in the cartoon that even old adults can find useful if applied in their lives. And people are just like, yeah, dude. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And finally, you know, he'll move on to another person. And I was like, please, God.
Not me. Not me.
Lord Jesus, Buddha, Krishna, Allah, whichever one of you, and the life force behind it all, I entreat you. Please do not let him see me. Do not let him approach me.
Do not see me.
Yeah. Do not see me. And of course, you know, I got my wish. At least I didn't get it as bad as some of the other fucking poor bastards did. But, you know, as the line started to move in, we got into the store and things became tighter, of course, because people got more excited. And the line also diverged at that point into standard edition and special edition, which was my worst fear. When I got inside the Best Buy, right?
Yeah.
My worst fear was realized, because this dude was like 6-7 people ahead of me, right? And I thought,
special
okay.
edition.
Yep.
Yep.
So I watched in horror as I first realized that the line split right inside the store into special edition, standard edition lines. And I watched in horror as all 6 of the dudes between me and him walked into the standard edition line.
I don't think you ever told this story to me before. That I remember.
Really?
I don't think so.
Oh, dude, that's the worst feeling ever. It's like, either like special or standard. You're like,
So the line is still hella long. Hella long. Like, it's not like unsurmounted, but there's still like 20 people in the special edition line, right? Ahead of me.
Right.
And it's me right behind this fucking guy. And he goes for the person in front of him at first. Oh, hello, my name is, and I can't remember what his name is, Billy Bumpkin. I'll just make up a name. My name is Billy Bumpkin, and how are you? Yes, I see you're getting the collector's edition of Diablo 3. How long have you been waiting for the release of this? Yes, me too. It's like, you know, he had these pre-canned answers. Like, whatever answer they gave, he gave the same shit, right? And I was like, okay, thank God he's latched onto that person. Maybe this line will move faster. But of course, it's Best Buy, so it didn't. The line was interminable. I didn't get out of there until 2:30 in the morning. You know, it was supposed to be a midnight release, and it's 2:30, and I'm running from Billy Bumpkin the Brony. But anyway, at some point, my worst nightmare is realized. This dude turns like Gary Oldman's Dracula. You know? If I could, you know, and I could feel his eyes on me, and I'm trying desperately to look
God,
at like,
oh, God. I know you're doing. You're doing everything. You're like looking around the store. You turn away from him.
Yeah. And this is before I carried a cell phone with me everywhere and shit. Like, I know it's well after that, but I didn't have one. I had a cell phone, but it wasn't a smartphone, you know? So I couldn't be just like, bleep, bloop, boop, bleep, bloop, 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 bloop,
forever. Yeah, that's nice, bro. Yeah.
So the guy, finally, my eyes just kind of ashamedly glance over me. And I lock eyes with him for a second, and he says, "Hello, my name is Billy Blumbo," or whatever I said.
Bumpkin.
I'm like, "Hi, Billy." And he goes, "I see you're in the collector's edition line." And I'm like, yeah, man. I see you're in the same line. Yes, I am. I've been waiting a very long time for this release. How long have you been waiting for this release? I was like, oh, man, I don't know. You know, I played the first Diablo when I was a little kid. Oh, wow, the first Diablo. Yes, I've played it. It's not my favorite of the series. But if you were playing back then, not to be rude, but you must be an older, you know, I just went on and on. And I was like, oh, fuck me.
No,
but it finally got to the point. And he was like, I actually run a website, a blog, and a general information site that you might find very interesting. And I was like, really? He said, yes. And he said, I can give it to you. It's very easy to remember. It's www.philadelphia.com. It's Philly like a female horse, not spelled with a P like the actual city. Philadelphia.com. Do you know why it's Philly like a female horse? And I was like, because you're a brony. And he was like, yes, I'm glad to hear that you've heard of bronies. Are you yourself a brony? I was like, nah.
No, not interested.
So this went on for what seemed like 18 hours, but was probably more like half an hour, you know.
Oh,
and
man.
I got my shit and I ran. But yeah, being trapped in a situation, because like I really, my option was to just leave and get it tomorrow, you know.
Yeah.
I could have done that, but I just needed to see Diablo 3 that night, you know?
I was,
you know what?
You must have been desperate, dude, to stand in line with a fucking brony. Oh, man, especially one that's trying to sell you. Dude, I've been totally different than you, Paul. It's been like, dude, I don't want to go to the site. I don't care. Leave me alone.
Dude, I got
to
tell you, dead ass, slaying that was harder than actually killing Diablo in the game. I toiled harder getting through that line with that dude talking about Philadelphia.com to me.
Which, by the way, I'm at right now.
Does it still exist?
Oh, yeah. It hasn't been updated since 2017. Or no, yeah. I'm sorry. There was a 2018 post. But yeah, it hasn't been updated in a couple of years, but it does exist still.
Yeah.
Well, it's still out there.
I am here at Philadelphia.com. I'm here. I'm looking. It's wintertime once again in Equestria. That's good.
Oh, Jesus.
It's wintertime once again in Equestria.
All right, TJ. Enough of a diversion.
What?
Sorry, dude.
What?
Paul,
the forum is still very active, Paul. Well, you can still go participate in the Philadelphia forum if you want.
Yeah, they can go there if they want. That's up to them.
Oh, man. Come on, Scotty. This is about My Little Pony now.
No, it's not.
My Little Pony. Aw, all right.
Don't let me fucking kick you, TJ.
Fine. Go ahead and do your dumb shit.
It broke my heart. It broke Scotty's heart to have to ban TJ from the call.
All right. I'm fucking good. Just go ahead and do your shit, Scotty. Talk about your nonsense.
Go ahead and do your shit, Scotty.
Go ahead and do your fucking shit. Yeah.
I don't need your fucking permission, TJ.
Yeah, go ahead.
You worthless sack of fucking dog shit.
Go ahead, Scotty.
You're probably one of these dupes back in the day. You know what you did? These medieval people, a lot of them, they probably realized, hey, the Earth's round. You'd be one of those dumbass, be like, flat Earth.
What? I'd do what now?
You'd be like, flat Earth. I'm TJ. I can't. I'm not even a good impression. I'm TJ.
Okay.
That'd be you, TJ.
All right.
You'd be the bad impression, TJ.
Yep. I don't even know what you're talking about, but okay.
Yeah. What do you mean I don't know what I'm talking about? You'd be one of the dumbasses in medieval Europe that had no fucking clue the earth was round, TJ. You'd be one of the dumbasses that believed it was flat.
I already believe it's flat.
Need to be explained to you in greater detail.
Yeah, I already believe it's flat. I'm sorry. I'm still here. I'm still at philadelphia.com. Looking,
TJ. It's like painful.
I'm looking
You're
at
painfully stupid. TJ.
I'm at philadelphia. I'm still at
philadelphia.com.
Oh, they have a fan art section. Oh my god, it's so great.
I told you, dude.
Look at all their ponies. My Little Pony. All right, I'm gonna just close this site because it's obviously too distracting. Go ahead, Scotty.
You'll be back.
Oh, don't worry, TJ. You will return.
I'm done with philadelphia.com.
Don't be a naysayer, TJ. You'll be back.
Only TJ checks out this site and is like, damn, this site's great. TJ, you a brownie?
No, but I'm pretty fascinated by it. I'm pretty I'm pretty fascinated.
Walk, DJ,
dude,
you'll gallop.
If you okay, so walk, I went to the forum section and it's all like, let's role play and stuff. And it's like, they just like give their pony stats and shit. And then there's like a little fan art section where there's like crayon drawings and shit of fucking like, here's my pony. I'm.
I kind of feel bad for telling this story now because I know I've unleashed some of the meanest people on the internet on this beautiful little pristine place.
Well, you know.
And they're probably going to descend upon it and destroy it.
You know what?
It needed to be destroyed. It just took me this long to amass an army large enough to do it.
Wrong. I'm going to tell you why you're wrong. Because that guy tried to spread the word to you. He's been trying to spread the word for years. I mean, you've spread the word. You've put it out to a number of people. And, you know, what they do, we have no control over those people.
Don't bring reality into this, Scotty. Let me have my illusions, please.
Yeah, if anything, you just did that guy a huge favor. He's been running this thing. It's been dying on the vine. Hasn't even updated it for 2 years.
Wow! The day I met you in line was the best day of my life.
Philadelphia.com's had seen the most traffic it's seen in years.
All thanks to this guy named Paul's ego. I love Paul. I want to be his friend and know him.
Oh, no.
Paul, let's be pen pals.
Paul, what town do you live in? I'm ready to move.
No.
You have a new neighbor moving in, Paul. It's your friend.
Knock, knock, neighbor. Recognize me, Billy Bumbo from the Best Buy. His last name keeps changing.
It doesn't matter what his last name is. He's like an entity now in my mind.
Oh. Bernie Sanders still trying to get 27 bucks out of me. Okay. Of Philadelphia.com. You're our savior, man. Look at all of these. Look at all of the pony representations that our community is drawn of you. You're our Princess Celestia. You're turning into Shaggy.
Well, I'm trying to make him sound older, you know.
Yeah.
He's got a few years on him, but he's still in the Brony game.
Yeah, you know.
You know, his Brony game is strong, Paul. His Brony game is strong.
Okay, anyway. TJ, quit trying to drag us into your
I'm sorry.
Brony porn.
I didn't fucking. There's not even any porn on it. It's like the role plays are innocent.
I guarantee you in that role play, they're mounting each other.
All right, hold on. Oh, look.
No, don't do it. I'm trying to get you away from there.
No, TJ. No.
All right.
So understanding the Earth is a globe, TJ.
Uh-huh.
So we have to go back really far to find people as dumb as TJ, but we can. So people in Europe probably did believe that the Earth was flat at one stage, but that was in the very early ancient period, possibly before the 4th century BCE, the very early phases of European civilization. So maybe basically when people didn't know any fucking about. It was around this time that Greek thinkers began only to realize the Earth was a globe, but calculated the precise dimensions of our planet. There was much discussion about competing size theory was correct and whether people lived on the other side of the world. The transition from the ancient world to the medieval one is often blamed for a loss of knowledge, a move backward. But the belief that the world was a globe is evident in writers from across the time period. So people had this shit figured out very early on. Well, there wasn't really much doubt about this as it's portrayed. Like, you know, it's portrayed as like up until very recent times that people believed the Earth was flat. Simply not fucking true.
Lies.
How about Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue? He had to fucking prove those people wrong, TJ. They all told Columbus the Earth is flat. The Earth is round.
I remember this, dude. The queen was like, brave Columbus. Listen well. I understand the spirit of adventure that burns in your heart, but please hearken. Thou goest to a most hideous and abrupt ending. Thou shalt fall off the planet if you should sail into the unknown waters. My lady, beyond the horizon lies more land, richer than you can even imagine. And if no man will go, if no man will brave the dark, then I, Christopher Columbus, and my brave, merry band of men, we shall do it for you. I will be back, and with more riches than you could ever imagine.
Oh, brave Columbus, would that it could be true.
That's how it went, right?
I'm pretty sure, dude. So, of course, it's bullshit. Despite a persistent legend, neither Columbus nor his Spanish patrons thought the Earth was a finite plane instead of a round planet. And you can blame one of the United States' greatest authors for creating a myth that still surrounds one of history's best-known figures. When Columbus set sail in 1492, he predicted he'd make landfall in Asia, as TJ said before. Legend has it that he defied Spanish officials to do so, sailing west instead of east because he was certain the world was round.
What a bold and courageous man.
Yeah, there's just one huge problem. It's almost certain that in the 1490s, nobody thought the Earth was flat. According to historian Jeffrey Burton Russell, no educated person in the history of Western civilization from the 3rd century BC onward believed that the Earth was flat. Well, maybe there's some exceptions.
Until today, but educated is kind of a, you know.
Of course, that was thanks to scientists, philosophers, mathematicians around as early as 600 BC, made observations the Earth was round. Such as, you know, some famous guys, Greek scholars like Pythagoras and Aristotle, determine that the planet is actually a sphere. So, of course, this knowledge was passed down. So, during Columbus's time, educated people would have carefully studied the knowledge passed down by the Greeks.
Or the if Asians. They're so smart, why didn't they, why didn't they have TV? They always tell me this guy, Dissicus and Natticus, Hooticus and Wooticus is always this smart guy that invented this whole concept of this, that, or the other thing. They're so smart. Why didn't I have TV?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, TJ. That wasn't
hard enough.
You question, TJ?
Yeah.
You ever seen a Roman TV?
Nope.
You ever seen a Roman Ford F-250 with the dualies in the back and the special hitch?
Nope.
Don't sound like that. Too smart.
And I'll ask you this, too.
I've never seen any of those things.
If they so smart, how come ain't none of them alive today?
That's a good point right there. You never do meet a Roman.
Mm-mm.
Nor descendant of one. They just went off, winked off into history because they're too dumb. Too dumb.
That sounds like a very plausible
Probably theory. Fell right off the flat earth thinking it was round. Misguided dude, dumb fucks that they were.
So, it's pretty much implausible that was the reason for Columbus's voyage. No one really would have believed that. I mean, today they would have believed it, but they're idiots now. I mean, people, if anything, people have just gotten dumber and dumber. However, Columbus ran into resistance when he tried to get funding for his landmark journey for a different reason. And TJ elucidated this, because basically he believed the circumference of the Earth was very small, and that by traveling west, that he thought what he thought was towards China, he'd open up new trade routes. He, of course, did not count on North America and South America blocking his way. So that was actually a bigger area of concern, as TJ said earlier. It wasn't really like, oh, the Earth is flat, you're going to fall off. It was like, oh, this seems like it's going to take way longer. And it doesn't seem like it's going to really you're gonna be able to actually reach this destination.
If there wasn't the you know North and South American continents in the way, he probably would. It would have just been a dim voyage. They all would have died at sea.
Probably so.
Right.
But they actually negotiated for years and argued about the length of the proposed journey because they had the same concerns. Like, yeah, we send you out and you never come back. And finally, it was like, okay, we'll do a shorter voyage. We'll do we'll prove the concept. And then eventually, Ferdinand II of Spain, his wife Isabella, financed his expedition.
She had an affair with him first, too, is what I heard. She fell in love with him.
Yeah, Columbus showed up and he was like, he's like, yeah, this fucking continent, just gold everywhere here. And he like couldn't find any gold, so he like ended up telling like the natives of some island, I can't remember the name of the island, but he was like, yeah, every person here needs to bring in two pounds of gold or some fucking crazy amount of gold, and they were all like, there's not even that much gold here. What the fuck is this guy talking about? And if you don't bring it, we'll chop your hands off. And they're like, okay. So a lot of them end up killing themselves or like running away from the island because they're like, there's not that. This motherfucker's crazy. He thinks there's gold here.
Well, he landed in like the Caribbean, right?
Well, this is on his second voyage. I don't know what landmass it was. It was some island, but he basically massacred the island. He's a piece of shit, or was.
Right. It looks like a lot of his voyages. I'm looking at a map here. Okay, if we actually can fucking look at the actual map.
Yeah, show us the map, Scotty. Pull it up.
All right, now it's too small here. And actually just readjusted this one to make this one. Oh.
Fail.
Well, I didn't have it. I didn't know you were going to want this.
Rafflecopter.
You failed us, Scotty. You goddamn failed.
So his first voyage is in the blue. He goes to Portugal, the Azores Islands. Yeah, then he basically reaches the Bahamas, it looks like.
Yeah.
Cuba.
Hey,
I guess Haiti. Somewhere around there. Then he goes back. His second voyage, pretty much the same area. Just the Caribbean. And I guess on his third voyage, he... briefly, it looks like touches on South America.
Hmm.
And Central America on his fourth voyage. Never actually reached North America, though. As you can see here, never touched anywhere around here.
What a dumb fuck. Missed a whole fucking giant-ass land. Like, he missed the giant landmass and somehow found all these little islands and shit.
You call him a dumb fuck, but he just basically like discovered an area of the world where he made himself God and like,
yep,
he did everything that you dream of, TJ. Why is he a dumb fuck?
Because he missed the fucking big ass landmass and just kept fucking going to these stupid islands and shit.
So the legend actually doesn't even come from Columbus's own lifetime. Rather, it was invented in 1828 when Washington Irving published The Life and Voyages of Christopher Columbus.
Actually, a lot of bullshit got its start with Washington Irving. This guy, he wrote some other books that, like, fucking gave people some really false impressions of a lot of fucking historical events. Because he really didn't give a fuck about it. He just wanted to tell a cool story. So, most of his stories are, like, 100% what Paul would call hot sauce.
Yeah, so Irving, a master storyteller, was already famous for tales like Rip Van Winkle and The Legend of Sleepy Hollow when he tackled the life of Columbus. His inspiration came from his friend Alexander Hill Everett, the United States minister to Spain. Invited Irving to stay with him in Madrid. So he gets to stay in Madrid. And of course, there's this huge archive of documents about Columbus. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to really explore this guy's biography. I'm going to write a book about him. Obviously, having access to all this information kind of makes sense. The archives may have been extensive, but Irving couldn't help from adding fictional flourishes to Columbus's already fascinating life. Crucially, he claimed that when the explorer told Spanish geographers the Earth was not actually flat, they refused to believe him, even questioning his faith and endangering his life. And this is a quote from some of the writings in the archives. Is anyone so foolish as to believe in people who walk with their heels upward and their head hanging down? One of the Catholic geographers supposedly exclaimed when Columbus told him the earth was a circle and not a flat line. Of course, the real fools were Irving's readers, who were actually taken in by his inaccurate account. When his book became a runaway bestseller, the supposed confrontation between the rational explorer and the dogmatic official was accepted as truth. Over the years,
I love it.
With the help of Antoine Jean Latron, a French author, the legend took hold. Even today, it is a commonly held belief, even though, of course, it sprung solely from the imagination of Washington Irving. Though Columbus never proved the Earth was round, he did manage to upset long-held dogma in another way when he ran across a continent that nobody in Europe even knew was there. Of course, his discovery was neither new, as the Americas have been known to indigenous people for thousands of years, and the Vikings since the 11th century. But as far as the Spanish and most other parts of Europe, this was like, oh, there's a whole new continent of land we can exploit.
Dude, I heard one of these fucking modern flat earthers make the same fucking argument about airplanes. It was like, if the world is round, if you took off in an airplane from California and you landed in southern South America, all the way down there, you would be upside down.
What?
Whoa. And I was like, what? And then he went through this explanation that made no sense. He was like, so at a certain point, if the earth is round, at a certain point, everybody beneath you is upside down compared to where you were when you started. But remember, you're in a plane. You've never turned upside down. Whoa. So when you try and land your plane, instead of landing gear first, you land on the roof.
Oh, dear God.
And I was like, okay, is this a... It went on and on. It was like a 21-minute video. And that was the premise.
Oh, yeah. No, dude. These guys will fly across the country, and they'll be like, well, I'm at this latitude and this longitude, and if this is true...
Dude, there was a guy... One of these guys that was like, oh, yeah, well, if the earth is really round, how come we never see a plane? Like, he had this, like, flat map of all the flights that were going on. He's like, how come I never see a plane go across this one and then reappear on this one, you know? Like, you never see a plane go off one edge and then appear on the other edge. Why is that? And then there was this, like, chick that was like, let me just debunk this really quick. And she just logged on to, like, a flight map. And then she's like, here's one that's approaching the edge. Oh, yep, now it's on the other side. There you go. It was just like, she literally just like pulled it up and like debunked it in like a second. This dude was like, oh, I've observed it for hours and I've never seen that happen once. It's like, it happens all the time.
I don't even know, dude. It's kind of like a wonder of the technological age that people take for granted technology that would only work if the earth was a sphere. And like GPS, for example, they'll use that and any modern instrument they can to try to prove the earth is flat. But there's some of these instruments that rely on the earth, assuming the earth is not flat. So I'm not really sure how that works. Mm. I'm not really sure how you accept everything that this claim is necessary to work assuming the earth is round. But then when it contradicts the earth being your theory of the earth being flat, then suddenly you're just like, nope, I don't accept that. Like, I just don't understand how you can even do that. Like, the mental gymnastics in order to be a flat earther are quite astonishing to me. But guys,
space fakes.
I mean, there's just so much. I mean, we'd be here all night. If it was a debunking flat earthers, we'd be here all night. How about this one, guys? You guys have probably heard about this one, right? You see this here? It's Amelia Bassanano. Is the lady who wrote all of Shakespeare's plays.
Make it bigger. Make it bigger. Bigging it up.
There's a poll from Facebook where this is kind of the size of the post. So this is Amelia Bassanano, who's the lady who wrote all of Shakespeare's plays, TJ. But because she was black, They would not publish her work. She died in poverty because she never received a dime for her work. Shakespeare was illiterate, can barely write his own name.
Yep.
Damn.
Some knowledge being dropped from you guys.
Mm-hmm.
I never knew.
I never knew this, man.
Emilia Bassano was the real author.
Except, I'm sorry, guys. It's actually not Emilia Bassano. This actually is here.
Oh. Huh.
Yeah.
Well, she's still a woman. She's not a black woman, but she's still a woman. Emilia Bassano, the real author.
Which actually doesn't attribute who actually Emilia Bassano is. Of course, this is an actual picture of her, and she clearly...
It's an actual picture. That's what you're saying? That's a photograph, Scotty? You're saying that's an
actual picture.
Actual picture, huh?
An actual picture of a portrait of her.
There okay, you go. Gotcha.
But of course, we have to examine the claim. The true Shakespeare? Is she? So a black woman named Emilia Bassano has been proved the true, uncredited author of all William Shakespeare's plays. Shockingly, this is false.
I don't buy it. I think it's true. I think it's totally true, dude.
So here's number one. First, Emilia Bassano, later Emilia Lanier, was indeed a published author and not someone whose work was suppressed because of her race or gender. In fact, the Shakespearean Authorship Trust notes that Bassano became, quote, the first woman to publish a book of original poetry when her work, Salve Deus Rex Judaeorum, was put into print in 1611.
Mm.
So, unfortunately, no, this person actually did publish work and was credited that. Also,
not black.
She was not black.
Oops.
Yep. Unfortunately, not black. No contemporaries accounts describe Bassano as black or African, and although its provenance is uncertain.
I mean, I knew she wasn't black when her name wasn't Quintetia, you know?
Oh, that's how you know?
Yeah, I just used the rule of thumb that Paul gave me earlier. It's like, is her name Quintetia or Laquisha or some shit like that?
Right.
It's like, nope, no, she's not black. And that's how I knew.
You can't say that, TJ. You've done a racism now.
I'm just following your lead, Paul.
Well, I apologize for that and have repudiated my earlier statements and recanted them.
Okay. Well, I guess I didn't realize that.
And
sorry.
Distanced myself from them, and now you're here making them again.
Gotcha. Oops. Oops.
Despicable. And lastly, the claim that Emilia Bassano wrote all of William Shakespeare's plays is a decidedly fringe notion, even within the world of Shakespearean authorship controversies. While she is listed as a potential candidate by the Shakespearean Authorship Trust, a group seemingly determined to credit Shakespeare's work to anyone but Shakespeare himself.
What is this urge?
I don't know. I'm really not sure.
What is why is this a thing? Like, why is there a group of people out there that's just like, God damn it, Shakespeare. There's no way it was fucking Shakespeare. There's no way Shakespeare wrote Shakespeare. There's just no fucking way. Anybody else?
I mean, a lot of it is because he just was not historically documented all that well. The commonly accepted portrait of him, there's no proof that he even looked like that. That, you know, he lived at a time where, the records weren't great and record keeping and there were no photographs and, nobody knows, you know what I mean? And so there's speculation that, you know, he must have been Lord Byron. You know, because only somebody with access to that kind of education could have written Shakespeare and, you know, yada, yada. It's stupid.
I actually, it wasn't on my document for some reason, but I actually polled what was considered to be the most accurate representation of William Shakespeare. And here it is. This is actually a bust that was made after his death. And was wildly, and obviously his family members saw this and thought it was fitting.
Am I supposed to be seeing this? Because I ain't seeing it.
Oh, you're not seeing it?
No, I'm still seeing the other page. I'm still seeing the Snopes page.
Okay. You see it now?
Nope.
Okay.
I don't see shit.
Anything now?
Nope.
All right, I'll just exit out of full screen, just drag into the document. I don't know why you don't see it.
I don't see it. All right, there we go. Now I sees it. Yeah, I mean, like, Shakespeare, this is pretty much what I thought Shakespeare looked like. Just a fucking bald dork with a stupid fucking beard and kind of has like a Mephisto beard and a dumb mustache and stuff, you know? It just fucking looks pretty much like I always thought Shakespeare looked. Just a bald dork. Yeah. Just a bald-headed fruit bitch.
But even among the group, of course, that she is as considered as possible candidates, she's just one of 66 candidates identified so far. Basically, long and short of it is that misattributed picture to a person who is definitely, maybe by some historical accounts, could be considered like Moorish, but not really necessarily viewed as black. And of course, no real, there's no real good reason to believe she wrote any of Shakespeare's work. Of course, that's our picture.
I have a controversial view on the whole Shakespeare thing. I think Shakespeare. I think Shakespeare wrote it.
Yeah,
that's my crazy fucking hypothesis. Maybe Shakespeare, the guy that everyone thinks of as the author of this material, is.
I would agree with you, but for some reason, there's like a thing. Like, I remember in school, I had this teacher. I think it was like 7th or 8th grade English. I think it was it was 9th grade English, and she was like, I know for a fact, I'm going to tell you this class now, this is something about William Shakespeare. William Shakespeare, if he existed, was a puppet, or it was nothing. Just a name put out. It was actually a woman that wrote all the works of Shakespeare, and I know that for a fact. And we're like, what woman is it? And she's like, well, I don't know, but I can just tell the way the characters are written and the way that the plays are portrayed and everything else, like, it's a woman that wrote these works. It's not a man. And I was like, okay. And, like, that was said to a class of people, and, like, I just couldn't believe it. I was like, how the fuck do you... And she provided no evidence, of course, to back any of this up. So there's, like, this thing with, like, a lot of people want to attribute Shakespeare to, like, whatever their bias is, where it's like, oh, it was a black woman that wrote it, and she never got any credit for it, and how, of course, some white dude exploited her figures, right? So it's just whatever cultural narrative you want to push, you know?
Well, before that... Like, before the cultural narrative of every white person that ever discovered anything was actually a black person became a thing, there was still, like, Shakespeare was really, you know, this author from the time period, or this author, or the...
Oh, it was more classist. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was all just, like, this insinuation. It's always, like, what's the simplest explanation? That Shakespeare was a dude who wasn't known for anything other than the plays that he wrote, or that there's this international ongoing conspiracy to conceal the genuine truth that Shakespeare didn't exist because he was X person. It's like, it falls apart at the seams. It's like, most likely he was just a guy that existed and wrote some plays and was really good at it. And he died, and they buried him, and that's it.
Yeah, I mean, Shakespeare in his time was probably more and better known as an actor than a writer. So
that's true.
You know, it's one of those things where it's like, yeah, he was famous enough for his time, but he just wasn't really a super famous figure. It was just later on, history looked favorably upon his works. I mean, that first folio being a big part of that, and people just rediscovered his works and loved it. But it happened years and years later. And like we said, there's not many documents. We actually know from the time period he lived, we actually know quite a bit about Shakespeare, because most people lived in those time periods. Unless you're like talking about like royalty, like, or kings or something, it's not well documented what fucking, you know, a bunch of plebs were doing in the fucking 15th or 16th centuries. Unless it's like talking about the big comings and goings, like a revolution or rebellion or some big act. So, of course, like you said, you know, if we just apply, Occam's razor, eventually we're just going to get down to the most simple explanation being Shakespeare just wrote this shit, and no one gave a fuck at the time, and no one bothered to write down every little detail of his life, going like, this guy's gonna be a fucking star! Didn't happen.
I mean, history, when it comes to people who weren't, like, heads of state at this time, is spotty at best. Yes, if it exists at all. I mean, history wasn't, you know... This isn't like it is now. Like, people weren't... celebrity wasn't the same thing. Like, Shakespeare's plays did very well. There's all, you know, every bit of evidence that people liked his shows a lot, but the culture that he lived in wasn't one that like celebrated the playwright. They celebrated the actors on the stage. It was like a proto version of our own celebrity worship and shit, which is why Shakespeare is known more for his now completely lost work on the stage. We don't know what roles he played or what he was known for. You know what I mean?
We know a couple of the roles he played, but we don't know. I mean, like, but yeah, he was definitely at the time more famous for being an actor. Actor was not thought of as a high profession back then, too. It wasn't the same way. Like, I mean, yeah, obviously people became famous, and there was definitely famous playwrights and stuff. But you know, that you would have got much more acclaim for being a writer, and more like academia and like social circles than you would have been for being an actor.
Right. Because theater was just entertainment. It wasn't seen as like high art.
No.
It was seen as like base entertainment for the plebs.
That it was.
It's like the equivalent of television, you know?
Yep.
How about this one, guys? The U.S. was just, we got to get to the moon. We got to get in space. We got to explore. The people just had an urge to, like, you know what, guys? We got to get out there. The American people demanded the government take us to the moon.
I still supposed to be looking at Shakespeare when you're... Okay, here we go.
Now we're moving on.
All right, cool.
The space race, gentlemen.
Space race.
So you guys know what this is?
Sputnik 1.
Yep. And actually modeled in Fallout 3... companion you have after Sputnik 1, clearly.
Yeah. I forget the name of that thing, but this is Sputnik.
Is it like ED?
Yeah, ED 88 or not 88 or something like that. I don't know. So when the Soviet Union launched Sputnik 1 into space in 1957, triggered a reactionary response from the United States, officially starting the space race.
Dude, I remember Stephen King in his book, I think it was Danse Macabre, or whatever. One of
my
those.
Favorite part of the book. Yeah, the most memorable part of the book.
Yeah, he talks about being in a movie theater as a kid, and he was about to watch like a double feature of horror movies. I think he might even have watched one of them already. But anyway, the fucking usher comes out and like announces like the Russians have a satellite up there. They fired at Sputnik 1, and they're in space. And there's like the hush came over the theater, and people were like, oh, the Russians are in space now. So it was like almost like the stuff on the screen was like who even cares about fucking radioactive mutant iguanas or whatever the fuck? The Russians are gonna fucking kill us all, you know?
Yep.
So it's just like a little snapshot of like how big of a deal that was at the time, where it's like, oh fuck. The Russians did what now?
Well, it was astonishing to people because, obviously with the atomic bomb, a lot of Americans probably felt for a while like, I mean, we're the baddest country. I mean,
yeah, and like, we're like way ahead of them, you know? They ain't even on a level. But then it's like, uh-oh, they just fucking, we just got served. What the fuck? And then it was on.
But yet again, another false narrative. So neither Eisenhower nor JFK really wanted a space race because they knew the huge strain it would put on the country's resources. Kennedy even advocated for a joint mission to the moon with the Soviet Union. Despite the huge cost, at least the American people, we really wanted the program. It was like, look, we know it's expensive. Well, we got to equal Russia. We got to get into space. We had to be the explorers. But the reality is, actually, only about half Americans were in favor of lunar exploration, even at the height of the Apollo missions. Polls showed that public approval toward the space program stayed under 50% for most of the 1960s. And it was among the first things that many people thought should be cut from the federal budget.
Man, human beings are fucking just over and over again, like the worst fucking stupidest creatures. Like, why did nature bother endowing us with intelligence if we were just going to use it to be fucking stupid?
I have no answer for that question.
All right.
Of course, actually only reached peak approval rating of 53% after Neil Armstrong took his, quote, giant leap for mankind. And oddly enough, like I thought, like, man, this program must have been, that must have been insanely expensive for people to have, you know, felt this way. Like, yeah, man, people don't approve of it. Oh, you know what? Cut it from the budget. If you put into context of how much money we spent on just total and utter bullshit in this country, it will astonish you how little we spent on the Apollo missions. The Apollo program's total cost was about $25.4 billion, which is about $152 billion in today's dollars. That to me was just astonishing to learn.
That's like stunning.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, because I'm thinking about the amount we've spent on wars and on trying to rebuild other countries and all this other shit, and it's like, people don't really realize it. Like, when I actually heard that number too, I'm like, wow. I mean, like, we spend more than that on the fucking debt of this country. We spend more on fucking just programs that are completely useless or just corporate welfare.
I mean, we spent an order, like, I don't know how many times that, bailing out the banks the last time they pushed the economy over the cliff with their wild speculation and shit. I don't know how many times that number, just to get them out of that one mess.
And think about the technological leaps that occurred because of the space program. Integrated circuitry. I mean, they've invented so many. I mean, rocket technology just was expanded greatly.
I mean,
by the way, thanks some Nazis, by the way.
Of course. I mean, this is why I kind of stand where I do, in terms of capitalism and the continuation of it. Because I see it as a yoke that has actually, you know, a lot of people go, capitalism drove all this consumer electronic stuff. And it's like, dude, it's this type of shit. Imagine if we had dumped the money that we spent in Korea, Vietnam, and all over the Middle East with regime change wars and these fucking like bullshit occupation wars. If every dollar and every drop of blood and treasure had been instead reallocated to NASA, there could be people living on the face of Mars sustainably right now. I genuinely believe that.
Oh, I believe you're right.
No, you're 100% right.
That might actually be undercutting.
Well, I mean, I guess I can't say that you're 100%, but I think you are.
When people talk about, like, why does it got to be now? Why does it got to be now? You know, it's like, that's why. It's because every fucking election cycle that we go through, where all this money is squandered on covering the bets of the rich on the stock market, and blowing up places in fucking parts of the world we can't afford to fucking do without the resources of. You know what I mean? If that shit was allocated to the genuine drive to, like, explore outer space and develop technologies that would let us go farther faster, we'd be all over this fucking solar system right now, in my estimation.
But, Paul, we got fucking tanks!
Tanks.
We've got aircraft carriers. We've got jets.
We've got largely the same fucking tanks that we had when I was a kid. The same jets, too. They're still, you know what a main American military fighter jet is? The fucking F-16 Hornet. The same one that was, I had hanging a model of it hanging over my bed when I was a little kid.
Well, the F-35 program, you know, to use our president's, our president's terminology, has been and is a disaster.
Yes, and he's actually right about that.
Oh, yeah. Anyone that says that is right about that. The program of the cost of its lifetime is estimated to be in the trillions of dollars.
The last time I saw a brand new piece of, like, jet technology was in the 80s when they unveiled the SR-71 Blackbird, the first stealth plane.
Oh, that's what the fuck, that fucking plane is super fast.
And then in the 90s, they unveiled the whatever the other one is, the one that looks like a flying wing. That's the last, like, new piece of aviation technology, military-wise, that I've seen. So this idea that we're just, like, even that money is being squandered. Like, we're being told it's, like, we're building the best. Why do we have the same jets we did when I was in pooping in my diapers and half of the TVs in America were still in black and white? Like, what happened? We can't do no better than the F-16. bullshit.
Well, it's called the American taxpayer gets fleeced yet again, Paul. That's what that's called. How about this, guys? One small step for man. How about a great moment of human history?
Very, very fine grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. Ground mass.
It was faked. It's fake. Look. Fake.
Hoax.
I see the string. I can see the string.
I can see Stanley Kubrick's thumb off the side. You see his thumb in the bottom right of the frame?
Yeah, there it is.
That's Kubrick's thumb. There it is. See the edge of the sound stage back there when he walked?
I do want to say that if Stanley Kubrick had shot the moon landing, it'd probably look better.
What do you mean if?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, we all know The Shining is his secret confession
see,
to
Stanley Kubrick
to that.
Is brilliant. He knew that if they shot it to look better, that nobody would believe it. He knew it had to look like a fuzzy signal from space, even though there's nothing to back up why they couldn't have just put a big fucking expensive, you know, 35 millimeter camera in a bubble and gotten some actual footage of space. Everybody just kind of accepted it because it, you know, oh yeah, well, it had to be, it came from space. It's like, what? Why didn't they tape it? Nobody asked that question, huh?
Yeah.
Ah. They didn't think about that, did they?
Didn't think about that. I never thought about it.
Think about this. Do you know what separates the inside of the lunar lander from the vacuum of space, TJ?
No.
About the equivalent of 3 sheets of tinfoil.
Wow.
Do you know what you have to fly through to get to the moon?
What?
It's called the Kuiper Belt.
Wow.
It's a belt of small asteroids between the Earth and the moon, a remnant of the formation of the moon.
Mm-hmm.
Filled with deadly projectiles, TJ.
Wow, that would have torn right through. That would have torn right through that tin foil.
Ranging in size from a Mack truck to a tiny little pinhead. And you know what those do when they bump up against tin foil that's going at the moon at 18,000 miles an hour, TJ?
Go right through it. Whole story just fucking doesn't add up.
Damn.
Nothing about this whole moon landing shit.
They flew a spaceship made of 3 sheets of tinfoil to the fucking moon through the Kuiper Belt. Okay, all right. Never mind the radiation belt that you have to pass through to get out of Earth's gravity and into the moon's gravity. That, by the way, tinfoil does not shield you from.
Yep, sorry. It was blind.
It's good for a hat to keep the aliens from picking up your brain thoughts. Transmission. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't protect you from any fucking radiation. So checkmate 1, checkmate 2. We all saw Stanley Kubrick's thumb. Checkmate 3. Hoax.
Hoax.
Wow.
Urban legend.
Not even remotely convincing either. Like they didn't even try to sell us on this shit. It's a total lie.
You know what Stanley Kubrick said? History is a pack of lies agreed upon.
Yep. And he knew. Wow. He knew from experience having shot that moon landing.
Well, guys, even if it was all a hoax, by landing on the moon or not landing on the moon, whatever you guys want to believe, the United States effectively won the space race, which had begun with Sputnik's launch in 1957. For their part, though, the Soviets had made 4 failed attempts to launch a lunar landing craft between 1969 in 1972, including a spectacular launch pad explosion in July of 1969, which I looked for, but I was not able to find. I was able to find recreations.
The USSR was not fond of releasing footage of its failures, and still, what remains of it is still not. So, yeah, not shocking that there's not easily available footage of that.
But actually, to my knowledge, it was only known publicly after the fall of the Soviet Union that these things had actually occurred.
Yeah, well, yeah, because they were failures.
yeah, of course. If they had been successes, yeah, the U.S. would have known immediately.
Yep.
From beginning to end, the American public's attention was captivated by the space race, and various developments by the Soviet and U.S. programs were heavily covered in the national media. This frenzy of interest was further encouraged.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Can you imagine if the fucking American news media had gotten their hands on that shit?
Oh, yeah.
Rusky.
Disastrous.
Rusky disaster. Stupid Russians attempt to launch missile. Only launch themselves into the grave. Launch pad mishap. Keystone Russian cops.
Whoa! Yeah, of course. Well, the way it was covered was just that, you know, we're in this fight, an almost an existential fight. So the way it was actually sold to Americans at all was like, this is a military thing. Like, if we lie to the Russians, you know, basically the ultimate bad guys get there first, they're going to have the advantage, and they'll be able to conquer the United States, they'll be able to nuke us, they'll do whatever the fuck they want to us. And of course, that means eventually then capitalism goes bye-bye, and communism sweeps through the American homeland. But of course, after the Russians' failures, which I'm sure the U.S. government knew of, with inclusion of the space race, U.S. government interest in lunar missions waned after the early 1970s. Simply, the Soviet Union had failed. They were kind of giving up, like, we can't do this lunar launch. Whatever reasons, it became politically expedient for the Soviet Union, I guess, after seeing the moon landing, to say, fuck that, we're not going to invest any more money. And sure. So this would really suggest that political reasons were the main factors that the United States space race even occurred. It was no real public demand. The public demand was just protect us from communism. And that, of course, was what people wanted. One reason why people disapproved of the space program was also the public's misperceived notion of NASA's budget. Polls showed that Americans believe that NASA receives up to, what percentage do you guys think? If you ask Americans, how much does NASA receive from the budget? What do you think someone's going
to
say?
Okay, so I'm trying to put myself in the fucking mindset of someone who doesn't know anything about anything.
Yes. Mr. Thomas Kirk, I would like to ask you about NASA's budget now. What percentage of the federal budget?
I'd say it's probably about 25% of the budget. 25%.
Yeah. I was going to say 20-30% myself. So, yeah, we're riding the same ballpark there.
25%.
So the average person said 22%. You guys had a pretty good estimate.
There we go now.
In truth, it actually only ever reached 4.3% at the height of the space race, and usually stays under 1%.
And guess what we've got? We've got Donald Trump. We got about half the cool shit that we would have had if we would have fucking invested in actual fucking technology and shit that would improve our lives with the money that we've wasted since the space race. And here we are arguing about which fucking creepy old man to put in the fucking, you know, chair and let flap his fucking toothless gums at us so we can pretend everything's going to be okay as we all die of a fucking preventable illness.
Well, all of our leading politicians, too, are basically just over-the-hill vampires.
Good morning. Sunday morning.
Yeah, they have to constantly reboot on air. We're sorry. Nancy Pelosi is currently loading. Please wait. Ah. Fucking nightmare.
Dude, I saw a tweet from Trump last night where he was like crowing about how like college football is back.
Look, it's back.
And I was just like, I wrote a tweet where and I wrote it out just like this to the best I could phonetically. President Trump went back FUBA. Dag vote for President Trump. That's what I wrote. And that's basically like what that was for.
President Trump done remember with the Liberals canceled football. First time in my lifetime. Cletus, you there?
No Cletus. Nobody's gonna pick up Cletus.
I'll be Cletus. You know, it ain't too, you know.
Oh, you suck, TJ. I'm replacing you as Cletus. What happened?
That ain't no Cletus, you son of a bitch.
That's Cletus, Paul.
How the fuck is that a Cletus? Cletus is like real.
How you gonna say Cletus like that? I think Cletus like this.
Cletus more like this, boy.
Oh, well, you a dumb son of a bitch, TJ. I smacked the piss out of
you. I'm the one true Cletus. You
give me a bowl of Skeeters.
You're both named Cletus, you dumb shits. What I'm trying to tell you is that President Trump said, hell no, liberals.
Damn.
We're bringing back football. And he brought back FUBA. We get to watch our FUBA now.
If I ever vote, he's going to be for him.
Him brought back FUBA.
That's beautiful.
How are we not gonna vote him? Him brought back FUBA.
Oh, I'd never even consider voting for fucking child molesting Joe Biden. You forget about that.
He didn't bring back FUBA, did he?
No FUBA under Biden.
I heard he said that he never wants to see another football game again.
Joe Biden don't even like FUBA. That's what I heard.
He said he gonna get rid of FUBA. Ain't gonna be no FUBA under
Biden. Shut up, low energy Cletus. Shut up, low energy Cletus.
You're low energy.
You're low energy. You ain't got nothing to say.
Man,
you're worthless.
They're probably busy watching FUBA thanks to President Trump.
God damn right.
MAGA.
You know, one thing I've noticed is that since the sports have been back, no matter what else is going on in the country, Twitter, all the trends are just sports trends. Like every night, any sports happening is just like.
Here's the thing. Can I tell you why I think that is? And I might be wrong.
Go ahead.
Twitter sees doom. And they're like, please, America, go back to caring about sports, okay? Because they know, dude, the red mirage is coming for us, dude.
The red. The
great split mirage. In 2020. It's fucking over, dude. They're trying to calm us with fucking bread and circuses, but the bread ain't fucking hearty enough and the circuses ain't entertaining enough, man. College FUBA, that's what you got for me right now when the world is burning? Trump, you got to do a little better than that.
Look, Paul, that's why we've talked about it. Bring back the Coliseum, put us in charge of it. Look, the bread and circuses will be fucking most excellent.
Oh my God, dude. You will see liberals and conservatives, pro-lifers and fucking pro-baby killers going completely fucking nuts on each other with a variety of modern and ancient weapons. Consensually, of course, to the death every night, 5 nights a week, live on Fox. That's got to be, by the way, guys, that's got to be the network we go after with this idea.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Fox is the only one to do it.
Well, Fox, look at what's going to happen. They're going to nationalize the news, and Fox is going to be the only station we're going to have available anyway. So we got to be smart about it.
So we got to get in on the ground floor of this. Dude, I'm telling you, if they're going to pull off this coup, which they're going to, by the way, they're going to do it, because Trump's going to win on election night, and then the ballots are going to get counted, and it's going to show that Joe Biden clearly won, but Trump's going to already have claimed victory and he's not going to leave office. And there's no protocol for that. So the military is going to go, who's the commander in chief? And they're going to follow dumbass Trump because he's the one that's been buttering their bread for 4 years and they don't know no better. And we're all fucked. So we got to start positioning ourselves, man. They're going to need some circuses, bro. FUBA ain't going to do it, dude. FUBA boring now, especially Kala FUBA.
Kala FUBA.
Kala FUBA. Call a FUBA back in the 90s, I could watch. But now FUBA, I don't even care about mainstream fucking NFL FUBA.
Well, I will say this, Paul. Your team, the Raiders, did beat the Saints.
Well, I mean, that's to be expected.
I can't say
because Saints are a bunch of bums.
Bum.
They were that game. Bums, I'll tell you what, the Raiders deserved to win that game. The Saints played like fucking Raiders, shit.
Scotty, they ran them out on a rail just like you do with a bum, Scotty. You send him packing with his little stick with a hanky tied to it, tied over his shoulder. Got an old stale biscuit and an old worn out shoe in it, Scotty. You kick him on down the road, back on down to Louisiana, back to the bog with you. That's what you do with a bum, Scotty. I didn't even know they beat him, and I don't care.
No, I mean, I know, but it's like, but yeah, I can't say shit. They got spanked. It wasn't even close.
FUBA.
Have you guys ever heard this one? Napoleon destroyed the nose of the Sphinx.
Yes, I've heard that several people were responsible for this.
No, I've actually never heard that.
You never heard that they chiseled the nose off the Sphinx?
Well, I mean, I never heard. I always thought it was just like due to like weather and shit.
So the Great Sphinx of Giza is, of course, one of the most famous landmarks of the world.
Yeah.
Is it mainly recognizable thanks to its most distinguishing feature? Of course, the missing nose, as TJ said, which he believed just happened naturally through erosion and time. At one point, though, people started to blame Napoleon for destroying the facial feature. Fucking goddamn Napoleon, dude.
Why Napoleon, though? That's what I want to know. I guess Napoleon's enemies probably spread this word.
And here's actually a more recent picture of the Sphinx. So according to the tale, the French emperor had his men blast the nose off with cannon fire. We're not sure exactly when or why the story first appeared, but it's easily proven false. The Brooklyn Museum has a sketch of the Sphinx for published in 1757, which I'll about now show you. And here it is.
That's not the Sphinx. That's the Southern Oracle.
This is the Sphinx ball.
The Sphinx.
The Southern Oracle, dude. That's the one that you have to, if you don't know yourself, it'll kill you. The eyes will open and it'll shoot the lasers at you and it kills you. You have to know who you really are. Yeah.
So these sketches belong to Danish explorer Frederik Louis Norden from his 1738 journey to Egypt. And he clearly depicts the Sphinx without its nose. This happened at least 3 decades before Napoleon was born. The story has also been debunked by eminent archaeologist Mark Lenner, who said that the Sphinx face showed signs of a rod or chisels being hammered into the nose and then being used to pry it off. As to the real perpetrator, the only written proof we have comes courtesy of the 15th century Egyptian historian Al-Makrazi, who wrote that a Sufi Muslim named Muhammad Saim al-Dahar destroyed the nose because he was angered by peasants praying to the Sphinx for a good harvest.
Hold on. I don't understand something now. You just said Egyptian, and then you just said historian. And that don't cotton where I come from. See, we know better than that. They never wrote nothing down. Them people was deaf and dumb basically till we came down there, is what I heard.
Yeah.
We brought a piece of paper down there with hello written on it, right?
Uh-huh.
And they took it and they just wiped their asses with it. They didn't even know we were trying to communicate first time we went down there. The first time the white man took an excursion over that way. You know, that's what I heard anyway.
That's what you heard?
That's what I heard, yeah.
Sounds so
this
accurate.
Idea that they was communicating this, or they was communicating that, or he's a historian, what was writing stuff down, what came from Egypt, I don't know. Ain't never been a historian. There's still, to this day, there ain't a single historian in Egypt.
Yeah. What do you say to that, redneck, Scotty?
Like redneck history of the United States.
To this day, they still ain't been able to pass the one single historian in Egypt.
Not
That's
even
what
one.
I heard.
Where'd you hear that from?
I heard that on Hannity and Combs way back in the day, before they got liberal.
Before they got liberal? Oh, Hannity's liberal now?
They had truth on there. They said there wasn't even one historian living in the whole country of Egypt. Whole country of Egypt.
What episode did you hear this on?
It was on one of them random Tuesday episodes. Combs came on. He was talking about some Combs, you know, how he used to do stupid fucking liberal he was. He come on. He says something about a historian that lived in Egypt and handed him like he used to do. He cut him right off. He said, actually, there's no evidence that there wherever it has been even a historian that's visited Egypt. So.
Well, how did they know there was no historians in Egypt, though?
Because if they were historians in Egypt, their historians would have wrote about it. You see what I'm saying? There's a definition.
This 3-year-old logic is blowing my mind.
Scotty, don't play dumb with me. When a historian goes to your country, that's the first historical event that happened. Of course, you're going to write it down if it happened, but I ain't never seen no tablet, no skull, no papyrus scroll, no goddamn zigzagging walk like an Egyptian. Yeah, papyrus scroll. That's what they used to.
A paprika scroll? What are you saying?
The papyrus is what they did. They didn't. Okay. Well, they say here's what it was. They's too dumb to have paper, and so they made this thing called papyrus that they made where they drug up out of the muck out of the river. Basically, they let it dry, big old mud cake. Basically,
so you believe a country that built the Great Pyramids and the Sphinx?
They didn't build them pyramids. You stupid! You didn't build them goddamn pyramids.
Well, who built it then?
Well, I tell you what, Scotty, take a little look to the north at another civilization that built some great things. The white man obviously went down there and built all that shit for them fucking dumbasses, and they tore it all to shit. Look how they did do it. The white man got tired of building on his own land because it was covered with everything that was beautiful and wonderful, so they went down to fucking Egypt, right? Built them up a Sphinx, built them up a pyramid or two, you know? Called themselves Pharaoh for a while, and then they got bored because them people are down there just too damn dumb to pick up on it. They were just shitting down the side of the pyramid, crawling it all up, and look what they did to the nose of the goddamn Sphinx. You think that's accidental? It wouldn't. They just too dumb. They're crawling all over it like a bunch of goddamn monkeys. So the white man got tired of it. We left. Left our ruins.
So Napoleon just came and shot the nose off just to be like, hey, you know what? Yeah. You guys have fucked this country up.
Like, you dumb motherfuckers. You don't deserve to have a whole head. Here's a noseless ass head to go with your shitty ass, stripped ass fucking pyramids that we took all the valuable shit out of. We're getting out of Dodge, motherfucker. Damn. That's how I heard it went down. But that, who am I? I just listen to historians, though.
Well, I guess I have to correct him in this episode. Napoleon actually did blow the nose off the Sphinx. Clearly, historical
listening. Of course, you did, character. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you?
You said you're listening to many historians. Like, many historians agree.
Of course, blow it right off. They should have blown the whole goddamn head off of it. But that's just me.
You know what? Maybe they were being nice. Maybe they're just being nice. You know, they had some pity for him.
Maybe they didn't have enough dynamite back then. You know.
Dynamite.
Enough cannonballs. Well, that is it. That's all I've got for you gentlemen with fake history.
So wait, who actually tore off the nose of the Sphinx? Was it that one guy? Muhammad Durango Fakango or whatever the fuck?
It was him. What'd you say his first name
Muhammad
was?
Sahim al-Dahar?
It was him.
It was
guilty.
Him?
Okay. Guilty.
He was a Muslim, so he was definitely guilty.
Well, I mean, I don't mean to, I ain't racist or nothing, but I'm telling you what, you line me up a Mohammed bin Al-Wazi and a Benjamin Jones and a Joe Franklin and
Joe Franklin, huh?
I can tell you who's done the damage. I'll tell you that much. I could point the finger right there.
Well, thank you.
Can I just do this for the rest of the goddamn podcast? Can I just be this character?
He's going to be the most ignorant racist character we can imagine.
So wait. Hold on, sir. Racist for telling the truth? Okay, all right. I see. What is an SJ?
I don't think. What character? You mean drop the Paul character and just be your true self?
Oh, TJ, you revealed my secret at last. After all,
I didn't know it was a secret. I thought everyone understood that Paul was just a fiction created.
Yeah, I'm glad I can drop the facade now and start telling the truth about the way things are. Because I tell you what, man, there's a lot of misconceptions in this world that need to be. I'll tell you what, a lot of misconceptions. That's all I'll say.
I think Paul needs to start a true informational, historically accurate podcast.
A lot of people's perception is way off about a lot of things. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They got their medulla oblongatas all twisted up in there.
It's time for you to fucking correct some fucking falsehoods out there in this world.
They said straight. They think a historian ever set foot in fucking Egypt. What's the point of that? To document what? I saw some dust. What'd you see when you looked to the north? I saw some more dust. What'd you see when you looked to the south? A bunch of brown people huddled up in some dust. Holy shit. Well, let me write a goddamn dissertation. Hold the phone. Give me the biggest tome that you can find. Let me write down everything about the dust. It just don't make no sense.
I love it.
Well, I mean, we'll have all night to correct all these historical inaccuracies.
But, this definitely is going to need a sequel because obviously Paul's got the real skinny on this shit.
Yeah, really, you know what?
Trying to end the episode early because I'm fucking bringing to light all the bullshit that gets talked. Well,
we're just trying to save some of these nuggets of wisdom for a future, future shit. Give it a little tease,
If I got anything, I got nuggets.
I guess the follow up the actual true history of the world.
Yeah. True history of the world. You want to hear from me? Yeah. Well, maybe that'll be the next episode I do, the true history of the world.
Maybe it will be.
I don't feel like I need to tell it. I feel like it ought to be obvious, but whatever. If y'all need me to walk through.
People might want to know, man. They might hear the shit we're talking about and say, man, Scotty's full of shit. We need to have the Paul truth here.
Need the real truth.
I'll do it.
All right. Well, thank you guys for watching. Have a good night.
Good night.
Let's see what you're missing out on, Plebs.
You dumb fucking simp.
Cut this man's dick.
Show for intellectuals only. Get out, Plebs.